Good evening, everyone. It's such a pleasure and honor today to have a conversation with architect Ravi Sarangan, director of Edifice Architects. Really looking forward to an interesting conversation. And looking forward to interesting questions and answers coming from both of us. So welcome to this live session. And great to get started. So very good evening, sir.
Hi, Mona. How are you?
Very good. Really a pleasure and honor to have you as a guest on Marshall Social. And you've been such an inspiration to me personally for the last 27 years of my career that, today is really a great moment for me to be able to do this with you. Yeah, thank you so much for accepting the invite.
Yeah, Mona, you've been always a perseverant soul, and I could never refuse this invite from you. So the minute you invited me, and I'm my pleasure too. My feeling is mutual. Honored to be here with you.
Thank you so much. So friends, just a small introduction, though a personality and celebrity like architect Ravi Sarangan doesn't need too much of introduction. Still, director of Edifice Architects, an architect by degree and profession, passed out of the AJ School of Architecture, co-founder of Edifice Consultants and director, a recipient of numerous awards and recognitions from within the fraternity. Ravi sir has been instrumental in growing Edifice and their current preeminent position within the profession. He currently oversees Edifice brand management, handles key clients, and participates in the creative design process. Ravi sir also delivers lectures on design and practice of architecture, as well as serves on the jury of various eminent design award competitions. Additionally, he spends time in identifying new leaders and grooming them to be future leaders within Edifice. Ravi sir has been intimately involved with several landmark projects. Prominent amongst them are projects like JSW, Capgemini, Amarjara Industries, Reliance, ADAG, and headquarters of Ministry of Renewable Energy and at New Delhi. So welcome once again, sir. And let's get started with our little chat. And I'm sure at the end of this, it is going to be a lot of inspiration for everyone in and around the interior design and architecture fraternity. So, sir, what inspired you to take up architecture as a profession?
Oh, it happened by chance. I never wanted to really get into architecture. Those days, it was typical for everyone to either take up medicine or engineering in the early 80s. And my parents were so disappointed that neither did my brother nor me got in, into engineering. And I had joined, I did my schooling in Xavier's as well as the 11th and 12th in Xavier's. And then I joined EcoStats Maths in Xavier's first year BSc. That's when my cousin, called me up and said, you've done your elementary and intermediate drawing exams. Why don't you write the entrance for JJ? So that's how I happened to write the entrance exam, and I stood 12th in the merit list. And then I realized if there's this one course which has put me on merit list, I might as well acknowledge that. And that's how I joined architecture. So my cousin was responsible. She, her name is Ranga. So she was the one who told me, you should write this exam. And then I suddenly get a call saying that I've got into architecture. That's how I joined JJ. And I never repented that act of mine, because JJ was such a dream. It's still so fresh in my memory. And that's how I entered architecture, and that's how I took up architecture. Yeah. So it happened by chance.
It was a brilliant chance, and whether it was good luck of the industry or your good luck, we still do not know.
Right. Yeah, certain things I think just happen, and you need to grab those opportunities and then make full use of it, right? So not everything happens as planned in your life, right? So there are these chance moments, and you take them on, and and then capitalize on that, right? And don't just, yeah.
It's also so important, sir, to stick to what you decide on, you know, because at, I think 11th and 12th, we are so raw that whatever you put one into, you know, one can mold oneself and take that up. But today...
So correct. You're dead right. I think even after 3 years of architecture at JJ, you still wonder whether you've taken the right decision. You're dead right. And that's why I think I like this, the new programs which are available for students, which is liberal arts, and where you join a course which is where I think you can major in economics, or you could major in arts, you could major in pure sciences, play sports, play music. And that's what I think liberal arts is such a great opportunity for kids of today. Not many institutions offer it, but yeah, you're right. At the age of 20, 22, maybe you know what you want to do. Whereas at 18 or 17, you really don't know what you want to do. Of course, today there are these career counselors. There are kids who know what they want to do, right? And when they're 8th or 9th standard, you see so many IIT classes, you see so many NEET classes and commerce classes, and now there are architecture classes. But somehow I feel that it's too early days for the kids. You're right.
I also feel what people lack today, you know, kids, is the attitude of giving up. You know, I remember that in our time, I mean, no course is easy, you know, and there are always times when you say you don't want to do this anymore and you just want to run away from it. But then being persistent and being there, you know, and completing it is so important. Today's generation, sir, tends to, you know, look at options. Okay, this I've done for so long, not working, another one. Done for so long, not working, another one. So not somewhere, true. You know, whatever you take up, you can excel in. You know, you've got to have that perseverance to continue and do things. I think that's something that has built us up.
Look at, I give this cricket analogy all the time, right? It's test cricket, yeah, not T20. Today is T20 time, whereas test cricket is true cricket, right? So you play over 5 days. It's similar. I think you need to persevere. You need to, you know, set these bigger goals and targets rather than just look at immediate, you know, results. And you need to develop that patience and, you know, work it. Everyone wants an easy ride to the top. It's no, it can't be. So you'll have to play the way Rahul Dravid played and not the way the current T20 players play. So,
sir, coming to cricket, you know, my first memory of you is playing cricket outside your office. So,
yeah, right.
I come with 10 catalogs in my hand, 10, 5 I'm carrying, 5 my driver is carrying, and, you know, we are huffing and puffing and checking, and you come around, you know, you're hitting a shot, you come around, okay, I'll help you kind of a thing, and I say, oh, I'm going to Edifice Architects, I want to meet Architect Ravi Sarangan, and you say, yes, I am Architect Ravi. And I do not know whether I should give you a catalog or I should do what with it. But
so it still goes on. So we play cricket more professionally now. Those days it was like we used to play this tennis ball cricket outside our office. Not too many jobs on hand then. And therefore we had this time to play our cricket. And our parents used to wonder, so much so that after I got married in 1994, my wife used to wonder, hey, what are these guys up to? Are they really working? Saturday, Sundays, they're playing their cricket. When you're on your own, right, you have this elbow room, right? You have time to pursue whatever your likes are, and therefore, this is the office when you came to Collector Colony, or was it at Pitru Chaya? I don't know where you came to. Was it to our garage?
No, not the garage, the first floor one.
Pitru Chaya at Govandia, right.
So, you know, before meeting you, I mean, in 2000 when wall covering started getting imported is when I started meeting architects and designers. So first my target was meeting Hafiz sir. And, you know, if you go to his office, there's a reception and then there is staircase and there he is up there, you know, and 3 months I used to just sit there waiting to get an appointment and opportunity to meet him after going with a reference of Nana sir. Mr. Nana Chudasma, So finally, when he met me, you know, the whole aspiration was someone sitting up there is what you have to meet, and that is the architect. And here I see you playing cricket, lifting catalogs. I came home in a complete shock.
Right.
Those are the kind of trends, sir, you've set and really changed the way, you know, one perceives and thinks of people, individuals. And so hats off to you for being so humble and so genuine, and it just continues. I think that's the way you are as a human being, which I really, really respect.
I think it's to do with your upbringing, right? Since our childhood, our parents taught us good values and taught us to respect one another, taught us to, the school that I studied in taught me to respect human beings, irrespective of their caste, creed, religion. Then you join JJ, and JJ is such a mind-blowingly wonderful place. It just builds your humility. If I learned anything in my early years of my human values, it was a JJ, where you learn to respect, where you learn to give back, where you learn to be humble, where you learn to really toil and work hard, and play hard too, because it was a great place to really have fun. Architecture was an extracurricular activity there till such time that you come to the fourth year, and then you realize that you're soon to be graduating as an architect. And that's when I came across a wonderful professor who was my thesis in charge, the late Mr. Y. Chandavarkar, and he kind of molded all the backbenchers. I was a big time backbencher right through the course of architecture, and he was a person who instilled some amount of seriousness in our minds. Having said that, I think that molded you. That entire 5 year stint in college, your parents, they mold you to be any especially in architecture. I think you need to, you're designing it for you, you're designing for human beings, so it's, you need to respect the human being first before you start designing for the human being, right? So that's where I think the humility comes in from. And I'm so fortunate to see that the minute you demonstrate respect, you demonstrate values, and you you're perceived to be humble, then, and it is immediately reciprocated at the other end, right? So and that's the best part of carrying values on your shoulders. The reciprocation gives you that feeling of satisfaction.
Sir, 34 years, 1987 is when you graduated. So how has the journey been, you know, through these 34 years of architecture?
Yeah, long time. And graduation just seems like yesterday. My daughter graduated this year, or sorry, last year as an architect. And I very well remember my days. For a long, long time after graduation, I used to still think that, you know, oh God, I need to give this final one exam, because it stayed on in your mind, right? Education, it just doesn't disappear. Early years were fun, as I said. We did our professional practice under individual firms, and then Sanjay, Nitin, and myself started work. It was called Take Three first, and then, you know, we adopted this name Edifice after an Asterix comic where the idiot architect is Asterix. Sorry, it's Edifix. And that's how the name came in. So 34 years, I would like to split that into maybe five or six phases. Yeah. The first phase, of course, phase of discovery, phase of facing the real world, phase of learning. The phase of learning is still not stopped, and that's the best part of, I think, being a service professional. Knowledge never ceases. So even right now, after 34 years, I'm learning new things and learning from everyone. You should be. I keep telling my own team members that ask questions. You know, keep asking questions. Otherwise, you are not going to gain knowledge. And that feeling of you know, aspiring, every bit of knowledge is still there. Those early days were good fun. We were you know, bachelors then. Then all of us got married, and the period of consolidation happened. We got our first breakthrough, and then we had to face an up. So it's a 7-year cycle, right? Those early years, every 7 years, there was this economist called Ravi Batra. He mentioned it very well that every 7 years is a peak and a dip and a peak and a dip. So what it taught us was those dips in the lows always teaches you better lessons than the peaks, because that's when you learn and you don't want to repeat that same mistake the second time around. And that continues even today at Edifice, that we always look at our faults, our drawbacks with, you know, with under a microscope all the time. And we rarely pat ourselves on the back, because I think that's where you learn, right? Where what if you've committed an error, to err is human, right? You will commit an error, but you need to kind of learn from that. So the dip taught us a lot of lessons. So then, you know, we had a split in partnership, and then Sanjay and myself continued with Edifice. That was 96, 97. So 7 years into practice, we faced this big hurdle. And then there was this, the economy had slumped. And then there's this one chance meeting which happened with that was one breakthrough, which I'll talk about it later. And then you faced, went ahead, and then the 2002, there was another dip. In 2008, there was another dip. And finally, you have this big mega dip in 2020. So it's been a high, low. But generally, the lows have been lesser than the highs. So it's kind of risen as an organization, both in terms of I would say, till 2008, it was all about turnover and growth and number and quantity and volume. But that big shift when the Lehman Brothers collapse happened and the world economy slumped, that was the turning point for us. And keep telling everyone that that was version, that is what you see is version 2 of Edifice from 2008 onwards till now. We are a completely different thinking firm. At least we are aiming to be a so-called design firm, not going after volumes. We're going more after quality. We're going more after true sustainability. We're going more after engaging the right individuals, the right talent. So we're working on a lot of other things, and still we are critical about the way we are working on projects or delivering projects. So it's been a kind of a roller coaster ride. I would say a snake and ladder game. And I think it's on number 70 or 72 is where Corona happened, and we are back to somewhere down there, but we'll claw our way back. Yeah, so it's been a roller coaster, right? 34 years.
So, sir, a lot of innovations, you know, that you've always been doing. And I mean, today also, if I go onto an Edifice website, I know who are the people behind each vertical, who's heading what, who are the directors. It's such an open book. You right. know, I think even 20 years back, I saw a photograph of your entire team with names. You know, right. Some number or email ID nahi hote, but name, everybody is there. So you've always, you know, believed in giving independence of working and showcasing each individual the way they are. So that gives a huge opportunity for people to learn, grow, and showcase their own talent.
Absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
Not just as a part of a firm, but also as an independent capacity. Now, right. I don't see too many firms doing that, primarily because of the fear that tomorrow, if this person becomes bigger than the organization, it's competition. But you've never feared that. You know, so... right from culture to values to doing such things that help everyone grow. I mean, how do you do that?
So it started right in the beginning. I think Sanjay, my co-founder and partner, and myself had laid the foundation very clearly that we are not going to name the firms after ourselves, because if we do that, then you're not allowing the other individuals to grow in the firm. And second is because the client is going to demand Ravi and Sanjay all the time, right? So we made a point that if we have to think big and grow big, and we always had a large firm format in mind, we'll need to invest in people first. So unlike all of the firms, which you know, I started looking for people after bagging projects, we did it the other way around. Whenever we came across good talent, when we came across good people, we would engage in a conversation, and 9 out of 10 times we would ask them to join us. And it was clear that that one had to invest in people and talent. So we looked after our people more than the way we look, more than the amount of time that we used to spend with a client, because we knew that in a service industry such as ours, you know, where the attrition rates are really high, you will need to have the right people supporting you. What we also did differently was, we knew that, you know, if you own 100% of the company, then you are going to have two fat rich men at the top, and then you're going to have the single pyramid where you know, you're not allowing the other people to grow. So what we did was, we knew how much of, you know, and I think that that's another thing that we knew, that we had to share our wealth if you needed to retain talent. And and it was called the Smiling Faces program when we started it, as opposed to a conventional firm, you've got a single pyramid and where you've got the owner sitting right on top. In Edifice, it's multiple pyramids. So you could be the top of a pyramid, and that's how the verticalization happened. And you have the corporate architecture vertical headed by Naveen Thomas, who's part of the management. You've got the developer vertical headed by Nilesh Dongre, who's also part of the management. You've got Sachin Bhatt and Manoj after me and Sanjay, who are kind of taking the show forward in Edifice. And you've got Sanjay Nayak, who's a brilliant designer, who's part of the management, who heads Design Council. You've got Sean Sengupta heading our business development and our Delhi office. Sangeeta Shenoy, who heads finance. And you've got Prashant Manjeshwar, who heads operations. And then we've got vertical heads for interiors and Sabarno and Prashant. All these people whom I'm mentioning has helped build Edifice. And they are the people and apart from these, there are many who are part of the team, part of the management, who have now started on their own. And they carry the same legacy forward in terms of values and in terms of passion for the profession. And it's heartening to see them carry the same values forward. So we invested in people, started sharing our wealth, built a program in place where there is an opportunity for every individual, not only to grow within the firm and attain greater heights. When they are recruited, I keep telling them that within 5 years of your time spent in Edifice, at whatever level you've come in, 5 to 6 years, you will be in a position to start something on your own, or you should be an associate in Edifice. That's what you should be aiming at. If you keep your eyes and ears open and you spend 5 to 6 years and you're good at your work and you show progress year on year, I think you can achieve something really big in Edifice, or you could start something on your own. Of course, times are tougher now. Scales are more, the scales that we handle, the complexities that we handle are much greater. So it may not be 5 to 7 years, but at least 8 to 10 years, you should be, you know, heading the pyramid or one rung lower in Edifice. So that's what we. So that has paid rich results for us, and the clients now can relate to anybody and everybody at the helm of affairs in Edifice. Very rarely do issues are escalated to me and Sanjay. Many people don't know me and Sanjay as well. So that's the way we had embarked on, and we've been successful on that end.
That's really wonderful, sir. And you know, I remember times where I mean, Diwali gifting is a known accepted fact, you know, but aapke yahan ek chocolate leke bhi nahi aa sakte the. It was such a strict no-no. So you know, I mean, there goes so much in building these things, which we completely as entrepreneurs understand. But you set your foot down. You said, no, this is... In fact, Diwali se 3 din pehle aapka office band hai. Playing cricket somewhere in the world. So great. I think you're not just building architects and designers, but you're also building humans who are entrepreneurs in their own right today.
So Mona,
So
I don't want to stop that at just with people within Edifice. What we have managed to do with our work ethic is that we have developed such a bond with suppliers, vendors, contractors, project managers, clients, who almost all of them have become a part of the family, and we've seen the kind of profession. If you demonstrate these values, and the vendors and suppliers reciprocated, and I've always maintained that any project it's an equilateral triangle, where the client, contractor, and the consultant, we form the three sides of a equilateral triangle. Nobody is bigger than the other. Although the client is funding it, the space cannot be done without an architect, and the space cannot be built without the contractor. So as long as you maintain that respect and this as an equilateral triangle, you will always, and good habits always are contagious, right? So immediately you will find that the contractor also starts following the same values. The client starts following. Of course, we are not here to change the world. There are several instances of these values or these ethics not being followed, but thankfully for us, whenever a client comes to us, he knows that he's going to get a good deal out here. And clients who don't come to us probably do not want to work with us for the same reasons.
Okay. I would say it is their loss because whenever we know there's a project we are doing with Edifice, it just brings a smile on the face. So great. A very unique thing that you did, get back all your professionals on your 25th anniversary and have a celebration. Most of them are competition or working with competitors. Maybe some are also in the corporate world and responsible for some projects coming to Edifice, but largely, they would all be, learning from you and moving out. So, what brought about the idea and what was the outcome?
Oh, Mona, it was not the 25th year, it was the 30th year. And we had moved into this new office in Deonar. And so we had this, we did, we have been wanting to show this office to clients and others. But we thought that rather than starting with a client, we should start off with our own team members who have helped build, as I said, Edifice in their own way. And then we said, what better way than to, many of them, they may be competitors, they may be working with competitors, they may be doing something different. You won't believe it. None of them, Mona, and over the years, and our office is access controlled. We have signed non-disclosure agreements with many clients. None of them need an access control card to come to our office. So if it's an ex-edifician, he or she just walks in. Wherever it's in Mumbai, Calcutta, Delhi, and nobody, in fact, questions them for having come inside without an access card. So this was a tradition over the years, and then we realized that this is the time where we need to call all of them, have this. 30 years is not a joke, and 30 years is practically your lifetime. And before me and Sanjay really got very old and started walking with walking sticks and all, he said that this is going to be a good time to call everyone. It was a fantastic initial idea, which was immediately, accepted by the rest of the team members and the management. And we were set about planning this whole thing. It took us about a month to kind of get it right, and it was so successful on January 26th of last year. And it was a tremendous turnout. It was a fun time, fun moments and f moment. And that's when you realize that, at least me and Sanjay realized that, yeah, we have done something good in life. The feeling of satisfaction, not to see our clients' offices and all come up, or your hotels come up, or hospitals come up. Yes, that will keep happening. But to see the entire family together, that was one big emotional moment for us.
Yeah, I mean, really, and something so much to learn from, sir.
Right.
Sometimes we don't want to look back and we want to forget our ex-employees and for whatever XYZ reasons, but I think we come together for a reason, and sometimes we have to part way for reasons which are beyond one's control.
Right.
So, nothing personal about it, and one should always cherish these moments that get
No, no, true.
created. You are responsible for creating that for so many. I think it would be a talk for a very, very long time.
Yeah, and it gives us so much happiness when I think about till about 3 years or 4 years back, there were at least in excess of 100 employees who I had sought loans from ICICI Bank and Kotak Bank for their home loans. And it was so nice to see at least 100 plus edificians buying their own homes, between the age of, say, 25 to 40. So what took me and Sanjay so much time to build up, to own our own home, which really goes to show that when you build your foundation for the rest to build on that superstructure, it becomes easier. But those were satisfying moments for us. When you share your wealth and you see that, you're taking, I wouldn't say taking care because it's mutual. I think they take care of edifice and edifice takes care of them. But so many individuals benefiting out of this is heartening to see.
Absolutely wonderful, sir. Absolutely. So, sir, when I asked you what topic should we be discussing on, you said client's happiness quotient. So, happiness, I think, is the underlining word, and client being the most important part of the equilateral triangle, one we have to deliver to. How do you bring about the happiness quotient for a client?
So three things, I think. First and foremost, earlier we used to see how many clients keep coming back to you, right? Out of a revenue of, say, 100 rupees, how much of that revenue is coming from existing clients, right? And how much is coming from new clients? If the figure was higher than 60 to 65 to 70 rupees, that means you're doing your job well. You're getting happy customers. And that is called that is in it's called retention marketing, right? So those were the first thing that we kind of set about. Then we realized that delivering a good project and the client calling you back is not just there. How has the journey been right through the course of the project, right? That would mean the first set of meetings that you hold. Then you have the design stage, which is broken down to pre-concept, concept. And then you have the tendering stage of a project where you float tenders, call for, and that's when, and then you have the execution, right? Now, each stage of this project can have these happy and painful moments, right? So the happy moments is when your concept is frozen on day one, you manage to capture your client's ideas, put them on paper, transform, you've extended his design thoughts and all, and you've demonstrated this. If at that stage you've done it without a hitch, we seek a feedback from our clients. So this at our feedback is not just at the end of the project, but we try to seek feedback at each stage of this project. So design stage is one, tendering stage is one. Tendering is when we float tenders, and it could be a painful moment for your client when you suddenly realize that your estimate was 100 rupees, whereas the vendors have quoted 130, 140, 150. Or the quantities that you have assumed is woefully inadequate. Mistakes do happen. So there is this, we keep this 5% contingency. Then we started walking that extra mile and telling our client, look, our estimate and the final cost of the project, there would be plus or minus 5% deviation. So that's how we kind of started getting processes in at each stage to ensure that this journey is also satisfactory and not just the end, right? So there is a honeymoon period in any project where you're meeting your clients, they're impressed with you, you've shaken hands, the fee has gone right, he's accepted it. That's the honeymoon period. The project starts, things can go wrong, but we are trying to minimize and try to be make it less painful for both of us, right? The third stage is where the client becomes a monkey and starts making a lot of changes because we've realized that when your documentation is not 100%, the client gets this elbow room to make changes. And you ask any architect, the painful moment is how to handle that change. because it means time and it means a time overrun, it means a cost overrun. So how do I minimize that? And then after that, tendering is the execution. Now, execution is when your drawings may not be accurate, your drawings may not reach on time, so on and so forth. So how do I ensure that also happens? So if I can make it seamless, this entire journey without a hitch, where every stage is seen as a milestone, where both of us shake hands and sign off. And therefore, at the end of the project, you get something done on time and within cost. That gives a big smile on the face of the client. On the inauguration day, he or she is going to come and hug you and say that, well done, well done, right? And the proof of the pudding is when you get a repeat order from the client. So this entire journey, while is extremely emotional, we've tried to document and make it in the background as a process. And that is yielding results, right? And of course, you have a helping hand in the form of a project manager who comes and makes this journey easier for you, or tries to make this journey easier for you. Half the times it becomes difficult for you. But because it's an added layer, I always find that a good project manager is one where he or she actually removes layers from a process, and the architect does the design, the vendor does his execution, and the project manager is doing his job, but he's invisible, and that's the best project manager. That's where the best projects happen, right? So this entire journey needs to be a pleasurable one, no hiccups, because remember this: an architecture project for an office or a hotel can go up to 4 years, 3 to 4 years. An interior project can take 6 months to a year, right? So it's a quite a span of time that we are talking about, and therefore you build this relationship with a client. I've always maintained that never see any project as a project. See it as a relationship, and that's when you will succeed. The minute you see it as a project and you see yourself as a consultant, and you always are counting on your fees. It is important. Fees is important. But if you see it as a job, then the project, you can never get a smile on the face of your client. But if you see it as a journey, as a relationship which is being built, you will always find higher levels of satisfaction.
So wonderfully put. You know, in the service industry, I always believe that you are only as good as the last service that you've given. And sometimes, you know, we though sell products, but still the customer satisfaction is not just by the product buying. It's about his experience in dealing with us. You
Absolutely.
Know, so if we've handled him well, if we've offered him tea, coffee, if we've reached the site on time, we've done certain suggestions and that has worked for him. Those things have much greater value than the product itself for which the client has come to us. So, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Very true. Very true. In fact, let me take this one step further. While I do expect to see a smile on the face of my client, I would definitely like to see the smiles on the faces of my project manager, on the faces of my contractors, suppliers, so that, you know, you're happy working on that project. I would definitely like to see the faces, smiles on the faces of the carpenter and mason at site, because those are the guys who are ultimately delivering whatever you have dreamt or whatever you have designed. And you will find that a good project is where all of them are happy at the end of the day. Few things that I learned early on in my life when I was doing a project for DuPont. And DuPont is extremely safety conscious. They're extremely, safety, of course, is paramount, but they're also so good in treating the white collar and blue collar worker at on par. So even if it's a worker, he doesn't work beyond 8 hours. He wears his safety gloves, his safety shoes, his hard hat, glasses. His labor quarters and labor toilets will be on par with the staff toilets and staff quarters. Nobody will work beyond 8 hours. There's no question of overtime. Eight or was it 12 hours? I'm not too sure. But nobody does overtime. And because they said that beyond a particular time, you're unproductive. A human being can work only for a specific period of time and goes to architects as well as the labor. And beyond that, it's rest time. You cannot be working. There would be a weekly off on Sunday. And surprise, surprise, that project finished ahead of time. No accidents, no rework. And the contract, the carpenters and masons started demanding hard hats and glasses for their next site. Even so, if you respect the smallest worker at your site and create conditions which are conducive to, you know, happy working, you will find that the project is will always deliver, will be delivered well.
Yeah, and that's the last mile for us, sir, because they are the ones who are end of the day executing work. So, so crucial and critical. So, great. I think this is a great learning for everyone who's listening to you on this. So, sir, you know, you've been an inspiration to so many. Who's the one inspiration you look up to?
So, beginning years of my practice, I think, surely, for me personally, it has been Narayan Murthy, Mr. Narayan Murthy, and Mr. Ratan Tata, I think. Of course, I have never had the opportunity of meeting Mr. Tata, but my team has met. Some of my team members have met Mr. Asim Premji also. These were the people who invested in us. And even today, I think more than 35% of our earning comes from the Tata Group. Early years of our lives, we still hold retain Infosys as our client after 25 years of working with them. So for me, I think they are my heroes as individuals. I think they have been, paving the way for us, to teaching us the right values and people had written us off, okay, in the 90s, early 90s, 95, 96. Array, how can this firm survive? The whole world is working in this manner. Why aren't you guys working in this manner? You should be accepting favors, gifts. but we stuck to our guns and it's yielded results. I think these were the people who, in the early years of our life, who kind of were still my heroes. Deep influence.
You would have had so many opportunities to meet these two people, you know, you look up to. So, hasn't it, pushed you enough to go and meet them, or you do not know what to do, you know, if you at all meet them?
So, as I told you, Mr. Murthy, I met him, and I met him on several occasions, and I wrote a letter to him in 1996. And I told him that we are a small firm and we were working out of our garage in Collector Colony and at Chembur. And I wrote to him and said that, you know, I'd like to meet you. We are a small firm. I get a letter within 10 days. Those were the courier days. Okay, those were the letter writing days. It was not the email days. And I got a letter saying that, come and meet me so-and-so date. And so I gave a call, borrowed money from my dad, flew to Bangalore. Met Mr. Mohandas Pai, Mr. Narayan Murthy, and then he said, okay, very good. I'd like to come and see your office. And our office was a garage then. He almost came to see it, but instead we went and met him at Bombay, showed him a couple of our projects then. I remember it was an export house, Parmeshwar Fashions, and then we showed him ICICM, ICIM at Siebes. And he was Krish and Mr. Narayan Murthy, they were there. And they liked it so much. And then we went on to do Manipal Center for them. So I met him. Mr. Tata, Ratan Tata, has been, for me personally, has been an enigma. But the rest of my team members, I met him. So we've just handed over a cancer hospital in Varanasi, where Manoj, my fellow director, met him. We are doing the vet hospital at Parel, where he's closely involved in that. Many several opportunities where my team members have met, but I haven't. But yeah, probably I was waiting at Bombay House for a meeting with the Tata Chemicals team. Suddenly I heard a couple of the stray dogs move out there behind, and then I see the security guard stiffen and say good morning, and I look back And I see Mr. Tata walking by, and he nodded. He looked at me, he said, good morning. And I said, wow, good morning. And then he just walked in. And that was one quick meeting with him. And that's about it, yeah.
Sir, I, you know, these people you mentioned, I just feel, sir, that the right kind of people, you know, who inspire you, the aura that they carry, sometimes just being around them, you know, makes you feel so good. I'm a big follower of Sadhguru, and right. When I was at the Isha Foundation, he just being in that room just made me cry. I do not know why, but it just, so does it, you know, when I see Mr. Ratan Tata, tears just start flowing.
Right, correct. So, true, very true.
You've read so much about them, they've inspired you so much that just seeing them in person makes that kind of a difference and impact.
And you won't believe it. You know how many champions they have created, and there are so many now in India who are helping build India. There is Zoho's Vembu Srinivasan, you should hear him speak. He's cycling around in Tenkasi wearing a dhoti and going around. He's a founder of Zoho. And he's taking service industry to the villages. If you hear him speak and what he's done, fantastic. Then you feel so small and realize that you have miles to go, right, to reach that level.
Sir, this last 1 year, though, I really don't feel small. You know, I feel like a big entrepreneur who has supported 300 families. And, you know, when that कारीगर्स वाइफ कॉल्स माय मदर एंड सेज की थैंक यू आपने हमारे घर में राशन भरा है आई डोंट थिंक आई रियली नीड एनी मोर एक्नॉलेजमेंट और एनीबॉडी एल्स सो यू नो वी डन आर ओन बिट्स इन आर ओन लिटिल वेज आई डोंट थिंक वी शुड यू नो बी लिटिल देयर बट ऑफ कोर्स देयर इज सो मच इंस्पिरेशन दैट यू नो वन कैन ड्रॉ फ्रॉम
सच आई सडनली सॉ यू नो इन दिस कोविड टाइम्स you know, benevolence really, you know, being demonstrated by many. And you really, in the residential society that we live in, we never expected some individuals to be really large-hearted and walk that, you know, take care of those who couldn't afford to even, you know, exist or survive. Yes, it has shown, I mean, you look at Sonu Sood, you look at shining examples of so many people who have done tremendously well for humanity. And that's when you feel that all of us, in our own small way, need to go beyond our work life and do something for society. And that's when you will find that, it's not just a national spirit. I think you should do it for humanity.
Sir, I think you also owe it to yourself, because when you do these good gestures, somewhere within you something right clicks.
Correct. Absolutely.
So, you know, it makes so much of a difference. So, sir, this 1 year of down, this 1 year of learning, how has, of course, you know, Oedipus has always been so technology advanced. You know, you've always adapted to technology in the fastest manner possible. I think you must be doing Zoom meetings for 10 years now. So, you know, how has this impacted business, and where do you see it taking things forward?
No. So let me correct your statement that we would have done Zoom meeting. No, we didn't. I think calamities teach you lessons. We always believed in a face-to-face service, because it is a service industry that we are offering. But we soon realized that, you know, a lot of things can be done from home. I've always maintained this, that man is a social animal. This too will pass. The pandemic is not here to last that long. We would come up, the human being would come out with a vaccine at some point in time. And things will get back to normalcy soon. Right? Because you yourself realize that work from home has its limitations. An architect can work from home, an IT engineer can work from home, many can work from home. But to what extent, to what level, to what levels of concentration, to what... And we soon realized that beyond 6 months, it was for a student, it was painful. My younger one is doing her fine arts. She hasn't been able to go to MSU Baroda. And I can see the pain in her. And it's very difficult for a student online education, very difficult for professionals such as us. So what we need to learn lessons from this pandemic. One is, of course, when your prime minister told you to build your own toilets, when he talked about Swachhata Abhiyan, we all, many poo-pooed and many laughed and many said that, you know, but that was the need of the hour: hygiene, cleanliness, you know, building your own toilets and no open defecation. And we all, you know, we shrugged it off. Later, some of my friends who, my trainer, for instance, my physical trainer, he laughed and he said, I live in a chawl and there are common toilets for everyone. Why should I waste, you know, 20 square feet of my space and build a toilet? As soon as Corona started, this guy went quickly and built a toilet for himself, right? So at that level, when things are, you know, we have to look at India from that level, that if we can start at the bottom of the pyramid, learn lessons for that set of people. Mind you, our villages are extremely clean. They're very hygienic. They have a lifestyle which is much better than the urban lifestyle, the urban sprawl. And the same person who's staying in hygienic conditions in a goodish house in the village is coming and staying in a micro apartment, sharing that with 10 different people and in unhygienic conditions. So lessons learned is we need to be aware of densities when we are planning. We need to be aware of optimum densities, that I mean. We need to be aware that we cannot be overcrowding anymore. We need to be aware that we need to maintain levels of hygiene and cleanliness. And this is a golden opportunity for India. So the way we latched on to the information technology boom and the telecom boom, right? Our telecom network or technology is better than the US, for instance, because we leapfrogged. We didn't have a legacy. We just leapfrogged into that. We adopted it sooner than the rest of the world. So this is an opportunity for us to learn and not go back to our old ways of living. And it is possible. It requires some amount of danda in India. Nothing works without a rule and a fine. And see the way the masks, right? If you didn't find them, they wouldn't wear their masks.
Yeah.
And therefore, we are slow learners. And unfortunate part is that for every three steps that we take forward, look at the farm laws. It's for the benefit of the farmers. But for every three steps that we are taking forward, there are four guys pulling you back. So it is painful, this journey, but I am optimistic and India will do well.
I think we today have more optimistic people, sir. You know, and we value associations. We've rebuilt on them in this past 1 year. And I'm sure the journey ahead will be a much stronger, bonded journey with everyone around.
True, so very true.
Little does one know about you as a person, as an individual, about your family and so on. So please tell us something, sir, about your family.
So my wife is Swati. She hails from Trichy. And she's a hospital management graduate. Unfortunately, she never pursued a career and took care of my two lovely daughters. But she keeps complaining that my first partner is, of course, Sanjay Srinivasan. And then her position is second in the hierarchy. Of course, you know, early years, I think Sanjay's wife Radhika and my wife Swati were the pillars without whom I don't think that we would have built edifice to this level. And in the 30-year celebration, they were the first invitees, both of them, to come and participate. And they knew practically everyone in the early years of our career. And then I've got two lovely daughters. I've got Vibha, we call her Vibha. So she's just graduated as an architect and currently working with me, but she wants to join after a few months. She wants to learn a few software thing. Then I told you about my second daughter, Vasu. She's joined her fine arts at MSU Baroda and looking forward to, and she's good at painting, and so she's doing design there, and she's going to be going there. So that's my family.
So
and Pandya also has two daughters who are 1 year older than my daughters. So the older one is an IT professional, the second one, Nishu, is an architect, budding architect. So yeah.
So sir, how happy do you feel when children take on the profession that you spent 30 years of your life in?
So we didn't force any of them to join architect, and that happened by their own choice. And they have to come up they have to go through this grind. They have to nothing is comes on a platter to anyone from our family. I think at Edifice only merit will offer you the role that you play. So she'll have to come through the conventional ladder, and there's nothing. So she would, I'm happy that she's taken the course. It is going to be, this is early years, right, for her. She needs to work on projects to really understand architecture. And hopefully she would like the profession and take it forward. And hopefully one day she will be at a senior level in Edifice, hopefully.
Sir, without the grind, you will never get a diamond. So I so strongly believe that grind is a must.
Absolutely.
And the culture that you have in Edifice, you know, that only on merit one will proceed, is so, you know, challenges one, and that is the beauty of, you know, building one's career and growing. But a great satisfaction that your daughter has liked what you do and taken on to it.
Yeah, it is, of course. But and I'm also satisfied with my second daughter for having chosen fine arts. To each his own, right? So, you know, I keep saying that future is bright for each and every one of us. It's just that it's up to you to take that forward, right? So,
my dad pushed me into interior designing, and when I came out and got into business, half a day he kept me as his assistant, and then he threw me out. He said, "You're asking too many questions, not letting me work. You go and do what you want to do." And then I had to get into every department, and you know, then he used to get feedback that she's doing well here, there, wherever. And then I got my sales and marketing line. And whatever I liked doing, he gave it to me. And he and my brother are such good pals that whatever I didn't want to do, everything went to my brother. So daughters have a big advantage with fathers.
Right.
Can I do a quick rapid fire with you?
Sure, sure.
Okay, so your first job?
I interned at Master and Associates. This was Uday Master and Deepak Master at Fort. So that's where I worked under him and under Samira Rathod. Samira was also working there. Samira was an eminent architect. So I worked under Samira there.
Okay, wonderful. So, sir, your first pay, who did it go to?
To myself.
Oh, you didn't, the parents, aise, some mandir, some...
So that happened much later. My first pay, I remember 1600 rupees. I went back to JJ to celebrate it with my friends, my juniors in JJ. I still remember that day. So.
Okay. So if you had not been an architect, what would you be?
Maybe a cricketer. Yeah. I would have taken cricket as a profession.
So batsman, na?
I bowl and I bat a bit. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. What do you do when you are not working?
Watch. I read books and I watch movies.
Okay.
And I love traveling I do a lot of road travel with my family.
Okay.
So we've explored India on road, by road. So that's the biggest, you know, thing to look forward to for me in a year, at least twice.
Wow. So what's your hidden talent?
I think it's the sport that I play, cricket. Yeah.
Okay.
So I don't know anything else other than architecture and cricket. I don't think I can't cook for peanuts. I can't sing, I can't dance, I can't. So this is it. Yeah.
So something that you would want to change about yourself?
Ah, something that
Should
I
I ask
think.
you why, sir?
So I think if I lack in something, that is focus, you know, beyond 10 minutes in any task. So I need to be there. I need to still work on my patience levels. Yeah. So it shows on my work. It shows in the way I play my game. So I'd like to work on it further. So increase this focus and attention. And it is easy. It's just that I think I need to work on it. That's all.
Like you've done now, you're almost chatting for an hour. So your advice to aspiring architects and interior designers?
Yeah, be original. Try not to copy. Stay true to yourself. Respect your client, because a good client is very rare to find. You know, for our profession, you need patrons, and patrons are rare to come by. So when you get a client, when you get a patron, ensure that, as Gandhiji had said, now your client is God. So value your profession, value your service, and be truthful. Don't cheat, don't lie, and be original in your thought. Being original in your thought is probably the toughest. The rest is easy. If you're honest, if you are diligent, if you're hardworking, it comes very as a matter of fact for you. The tough part is to push your, you know, work on your creative skills, which will evolve over time. But try to be as original as possible. Don't copy.
Yeah, I think it's more about believing in yourself and looking inward, you know, because the whole world is inside you.
So, no, Mona, you're right. So you can't. You're not. Not everyone is a Sachin Tendulkar, or not everyone is a Ronaldo, right? We're all. I think most of us are. I'm not saying, for the sake of saying it, but all of us are moderate, right? When you have a feeling that you're moderate and you're not special, you will work, you know, always better than what you were before, and therefore. You need to know your limitations also. You can't be the best in everything, right? So you need to give your best shot. That may not be your best result, but at the same time, you need to get the have the feeling that, yes, I've given it the best shot. And therefore, your original thoughts, your conscience should say, yes, I have done my best to my abilities. So, and as I said, you may not be the best at everything. You may not be, but you have given it your 100%. That's important for me.
Super. So three words that describe you.
Never give up. That's probably one. If there is a word which says don't give up. Second is have fun, right? And the third is respect one another. So these are three attributes that I'm sorry, I cannot. I didn't find three words to describe this, but these three words probably would sum me up.
Sir, it's been such a pleasure and honor to talk to you. This is going to be down with me for a very, very long time, and so much to learn and take inspiration from. I thank you so much from the bottom of my heart for taking time out, and hats off to you for whatever you're doing, sir.
Thanks, Mona, and the feeling is mutual. I enjoyed this conversation, and I like it when it's completely extempore, and then the answers really come honestly out of you. So it's been a wonderful time. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.